So this is today. Today is yesterday, and tomorrow is also today.
You traveled through time to the present.
Yes.
Yeah, I don't think you get how time travel works.
It's like we're stuck. You know, like a needle on a scratch record.
I wake up every day right here, right in Punxsutawney, and it's always February 2nd.
It's one of those infinite time loop situations you might have heard about.
It's a thing where the same day keeps happening.
In a damn time loop or something.
Groundhog Day Project blog, day 288, dated 17th May 2014. Fix your bra, honey. Before I get into it, I'm reading this one because the last one I recorded, 290, mentioned this epic thing about sexism, and I was curious. I'll get to the science of Groundhog Day the holiday next time, which is a different entry.
Jumping in from editing, because as it turns out, it won't be next time. It'll be in a few weeks. This epic entry takes a while. It gets me a couple other entries that I just had to read, and well, you'll see. Anyway, back to fix your bra, honey.
Patriarchy. Noun. A family group or government controlled by a man or a group of men. A social system in which family members are related to each other through their fathers. Full definition. 1. Social organization marked by the supremacy of the father in the clan or family, the legal dependence of wives and children, and the reckoning of descent and inheritance in the male line. Broadly, control by men of a disproportionately large share of power. 2. A society or institution organized according to the principles or practices of patriarchy. Other forms, plural, patriarchies. First use, 1632. Before catching up to where I left off, the movie is on day 3 as I write this opening. I wanted to mention Barry Brummett's 2015. Seriously, this Google Books find has next year as its copyright. On the one hand, that means I guess this is an as yet unpublished book. On the other hand, Brummett is writing from the future and doesn't cite me. This makes me sad. The chapter title is Simulational Selves, Simulational Culture in Groundhog Day, and it's from an apparently upcoming fourth edition of Rhetoric in Popular Culture. Brummett claims it, the chapter, combines culture-centered and feminist techniques of rhetorical analysis to study the message this film brings us about our simulational world. That simulational world thing is basically the same thing as Paul Hannum's Groundhog Day effect. Caused by our unique set of behavioral and thought patterns, which create our personal reality, we do not directly experience the world around us, we experience a personal reality through our senses. Personal reality is a reflection of reality, not reality itself. So, in effect, there are two realities. The reality of what is, the real world, and the world as we see it. Our personal reality. We might not repeat the exact day over and over again in our outer lives, yet our personal reality can effectively create the same day again and again in our inner lives. Hannum, 2008. It's Giddens' structuration in action. You do things one way one time, the second time you do it the same way because, hey, it worked last time. By the third or the fourth time, you cannot even imagine doing it another way. The same process works for Phil's breed of sexism. I offered the definitions for both sexism and misogyny to start yesterday's entry. Don't worry, listeners, I'm not going to read that entry next. I don't think.
Spoilers from editing. I am.
But I don't think it's fair to suggest that Phil is a misogynist. Phil does not hate women. But he operates in a world where he has always been part of the dominant class. He is a white male in America. The power is his to lose. I suggested yesterday that Phil's interactions with Nancy are not sexist. While strictly true on the surface, that argument is entirely wrong when we look beneath that surface. Phil's specific interactions with Nancy may not contain anything particularly sexist, but generally speaking, they embody a patriarchal world in which men can readily take advantage of women by lying to them. Nancy is not stupid, I don't think. But she lives in a world that tells her constantly that she needs a man to complete her. We may need a whole aside here just to talk about playing Nancy. I mean, I'll get to it when Nancy's introduced in the movie, in this show. But I think at this point in the blog, I don't know if I'd listened to, or did it even exist yet, the Groundhog Day musical. I guess it wouldn't have existed yet. Playing Nancy embodies this exact idea of who Nancy is and how the world tells her to be it. Anyway, we'll get to that much later. I won't talk about the song in this. But she lives in a world that tells her constantly that she needs a man to complete her. So when a guy comes along with, who she might have known before and who apparently liked her, and she's still single after all these years, why wouldn't she say yes to a date? Why wouldn't she be at least flattered by a declaration of love and a proposal of marriage? That is what society has been saying she should do That is what society has been saying she should do since as far back as she can probably recall. This patriarchal world has Nancy backed into a corner, working in a dress shop and pining away for a man. Hell, there's probably at least one wedding dress on display in that dress shop. Date night continues. And I missed something at the end of yesterday's entry. When the first snowball fight gets going, Phil says the following. Hey, an assassin. I'll protect you, Your Majesty. I shall die for you. You shall not take her. Find cover, my lady. First, let me add another definition. Chivalry. Noun. The system of values, such as loyalty and honor, that knights in the Middle Ages were expected to follow. An honorable and polite way of behaving especially toward women. Full definition. 1. Mounted men-at-arms. 2. Archaic. A. Martial valor. B. Knightly skill. 3. Gallant or distinguished gentleman. 4. The system, spirit, or customs of medieval knighthood. 5. The qualities of the ideal knight, chivalrous conduct. Other forms, plural, chivalries. Origin, Middle English chivalry, from Anglo-French there's an extra syllable in there, not making sense to me when I try to say it. Because it's not chevalier, it's chevalry. From chevalier, knight. First use, 14th century. More of the same. Phil is enacting chivalrous behavior, but no matter how it may be literally defined, honorable and polite, chivalry relied on the notion that women were lesser beings in need of protection. Though this is the first snowball fight we see, Phil has a carrot and coal for the snowman, so he has been in this scene before. He knows the fight is coming. He has had time to prepare what he will say. He hasn't called Rita princess yet, but he will. If I remember rightly, calling her Your Majesty here implies she is a queen. So it may be sexist, but not as diminutive. I can't decide if it is sexist that Phil has ice cream. Stereotypes of single women sitting around eating ice cream and or chocolate, you know. And Phil calls Rita princess. As Phil is getting to his lowest point here, the depression stage, let us hope there are fewer things to note through the rest of this list than yesterday. See, that's the third time I've referenced yesterday's entry. Will next week's episode be yesterday's entry? We're going back in time. I love it. I'll just keep going backward until I get to the one with the science. No, that's like 100-some entries. For sure the science one wasn't early, in the first 100 days or so. Where are we? In the meantime, let's take a look at Brummett, 2015. Mostly, Brummett deals with the simulational thing more than feminist or sexist rhetoric. But Brummett makes the same sort of connection I made yesterday in saying that Phil cares little for others and insults people habitually, carelessly. If he approaches women, it is for his personal gratification. I would specifically note that he approaches men much the same way. Or rather, he doesn't approach them. It's interesting that we do not see Phil meet Gus and Ralph. Sure, they are at the tip-top, but Phil calls them morons. He does not befriend them. Does he latch onto these two locals because they can serve him? Be a sounding board for his thoughts about the time loop? Are they useful because they are drunk enough to listen? Anyway, Rummett continues. His exploitative stance toward women is clearly linked to his heedlessness of consequences generally. But this isn't quite fair. Phil's exploitative stance toward women, within the context of the story we see, is clearly linked to his heedlessness of consequences generally. Wait, isn't that what his quote just said? Oh, okay. I'm confusing myself with my own writing here. That is a direct quote. I'm changing it for the context of the next line. So let's go again. Anyway, Brummett continues. His exploitative stance toward women is clearly linked to his heedlessness of consequences generally. End quote. But this isn't quite fair. Phil's exploitative stance toward women, within the context of the story we see, is clearly linked to his heedlessness of consequences generally. His presumed exploitative stance toward women pre-loop is linked to something else. Again, that patriarchal world in which Phil has white male privilege, and maybe there were not too many consequences even before the time loop. Back when Phil charmed all the little PAs at the station, all the secretaries, and even some of the weekend anchors. That's from the original script. We'll get to that. Phil, dead on the hospital bed, Rita manages to say, "That's him," but then ducks into Larry's shoulder. Larry, though, remains upright, even offers a disingenuous assessment of how much he liked Phil. Rita is the weaker sex here, Larry the white male in Phil's stead. In fact, it seems more relevant now that the doctor is black. The black doctor has no lines here. Rita has one, then diminishes into her emotional reaction. It is only the white male who really speaks. God day. Phil identifies Doris by her relation to a male, her brother-in-law, who owns the diner, and by her romantic and feminine urge to visit Paris. While he identifies Debbie only in relation to her upcoming marriage, a reification of traditional gender normative roles, it's interesting that he identifies Fred only in relation to Debbie. The one consolation for Phil, having just ruined Debbie's day. Rita compliments her on her ring, one woman complimenting another on her replacement for the bride price. It isn't just Phil being sexist in this scene. Another interesting detail in this sequence, Phil identifies Bill as a waiter, as liking the town, as painting toy soldiers, and, almost as if it is an afterthought, as being gay. Sure, he is identified by his sexuality, but since he presents as a white male, that is not the immediate concern. It is worth mentioning, but Bill is still almost part of the patriarchal club. He gets a pass, sort of. Gus, identified by his connection to his naval service, despite that old village people song, the Navy still makes for a masculine reference. Tom is identified by his work in the coal mine, another masculine job. The only tip-top denizen who gets off without a reference in some gendered way is Alice. That's Alice. She came over from Ireland as a baby. She's lived in Erie most of her life. Nancy is identified as working in the dress shop, a feminine job, and making noises like a chipmunk when she gets real excited. Imagine the latter detail, or the former for that matter, being applied to a male character. Rita's description. You like boats, but not the ocean. You go to a lake in the summer with your family up in the mountains. There's a long wooden dock and a boathouse with boards missing from the roof and a place you used to crawl underneath to be alone. You're a sucker for French poetry and rhinestones. You're very generous. You're kind to strangers and children. And when you stand in the snow, you look like an angel. It starts well enough. Then there's the French poetry and rhinestones line. And of course she looks like an angel. Then I included a diagram of some old drawing of angels. I don't know what it's from. And I said, wait, those are so-called actual angels, which isn't accurate. Angels in the Bible are actually not described as being particularly humanoid. They're much scarier. I should have put a scary one here, in here. And then I said, let's see Phil's idea of an angel, and it's his ice-sculpted version, which is, you know, cute and small, very dainty, feminine. Back to the text. Young, feminine, the fee he called Rita several scenes back. Gosh, you're an upbeat lady. Here's my problem now. Obsessing about a single film for 288 days now, plus majoring in communication studies, I wonder if upbeat isn't code like a racist would only call a black person uppity. I'm pretty sure it isn't, but I thought it worth mentioning that I wondered. Brummett, 2015, suggests, the film positions the female in the empowered position of being able to validate his experience. But I don't know if this argument rings true. Structurally, yes, Phil's release from the time loop seems to correlate at the least with his winning of Rita's affections. I've suggested before that it is little more than correlation, but for the audience's own expectations of what comes in a romantic comedy. Rita is the obvious prize for having won a much greater battle. What I mean is this. Phil's experience is not validated by Rita. It is validated by everyone who thanks him at the banquet, by everyone he has been able to help, by his own accomplishments in making himself a better person, and finally by we, the members of the audience. Rita is more a symbolic representative of what Phil has achieved than an example of that achievement. So no, the film does not put the female in the empowered position. In fact, women are just fodder for Phil's exercises of power. To be fair, so are the men. To suggest that women are in the empowered position within the film would be like suggesting that women are in the empowered position in the most exploitative of slasher films. Sure, there is a tiny, tiny little feeling that the last woman standing is empowered because she fought off the bad guy, if it isn't an everyone dies kind of slasher film. Sonia Charlotte Rainey tells us in The Final Girl and Scream Queens, a feminist call for the revival of slasher films, The Artivist, 21st April of 2013, numerous studies indicate that though horror audiences are predominantly male, the number of women watching, and indeed enjoying, these films is on the rise, and has been since the heyday of slashers. It has been suggested that women get a kick out of watching a young girl defeat the apparently indestructible killer, when no macho jock or cop could. It's a form of empowerment, in a sense. Does her victory over that one male suddenly mean she has a greater role in the larger society around her? No, not at all. In fact, Heidi Martinuzzi argues in Horror Show, Faux Feminism and Horror Films, Bitch Magazine, 29th October 2010, that taking the fact of the lone female survivor as feminist is wrong. Martinuzzi writes, "So why are all these movies touted by fans and filmmakers as feminist? Because men are the victims in them." It's creepy when you think about it, isn't it? The norm in horror films and in most cultures around the world is that men are seen as the aggressors and women the subservient and the victims. But switching the dynamic and putting men suddenly at the usually sexual mercy of a woman with intent to harm does nothing but reinforce the mainstream ideology that women with control of their sexuality, and by default their reproduction, are dangerous, intend harm, and will always turn on their male superiors. Movies in which teenage girls discover their sexuality and then use it solely to inflict harm on males, for the sake of revenge, is a guilty male fear, if I've ever seen one. So next time you want to call a horror film feminist, make sure it espouses gender equality, not the cutting off of penises by horny, monstrous women who like sex. On another level, this unidentified piece, Fear, Sex, and Feminism, Analysis of Slasher Films and the Texas Chainsaw Massacre, argues that the female characters who do survive in slasher films do so by exhibiting masculine traits and acting out in masculine ways. The author, presumably Yelena Karanovic, anthropologist of digital technologies and media, writes, "In addition to these poor portrayals of female characters, the fact that the final victim or character that often escapes is female is problematic when wearing feminist lenses. The final girl, as I will call her, opposes all of the negative female portrayals aforementioned. She is smart and more aware, brunette, non-sexual and usually a virgin, and less feminine, but still attractive and girl next door, in appearance. Meaning, less curves, tomboyish in physical appearance and disposition. Jessica Biel, who plays Erin..." Wait, what film is she talking about? What film is this? I don't know. Weird. I'm forgetting. Maybe I'll add it in editing. Do it.
Jessica Biel plays Erin Hardesty in the 2003 remake of Texas Chainsaw Massacre.
Oh, that's what it is.
I might never have seen that. That's probably why I wasn't thinking of it while reading this.
Jessica Biel, who plays Erin, easily fits this description and also is able to escape. This juxtaposition does not oppose the prior feminist critique, however, as it points out a more serious identification and message issue with this and other horror films. Erin's intelligence, along with her more athletic physique and stable mental state, are what allow her to escape from the killer's wrath. She is able to physically fight him off, something that none of the female characters were able to do. I gotta nitpick that sentence. It should have said other female characters. But whatever. Her problem, not mine. Her masculine features are what propel her to safety. Whew. Okay. This entry is kind of epic and long. And considering I spent a month talking about slasher films in this blog, plus did a whole podcast about Halloween, damn, I should really write a book about slasher films. I've also been watching slasher films, hundreds of them, since last September, and still have quite a few left. Trying to watch basically all of them ever, which is crazy. Anyway, back to the blog. Whether we take the helpless female victims or the masculine female survivor as sexism in action, there's clearly something wrong, or at least a trend evoking something wrong in the society around us. But just as I have suggested that maybe Phil isn't particularly sexist inasmuch as he is dismissive and insulting of anyone, regardless of gender, Holly L. Durr argues in A Feminist Guide to Horror Movies Part 4, Ms. Blog, 23rd October 2013, that more recent horror films, the so-called torture porn films, have actually moved away from the sexism and misogyny, my phrasing, of slasher films. She writes, from the mid-1970s to the mid-1980s, America feared the things hiding in the dark. The monsters under our beds were the invisible but menacing power of the Soviet Union, stagflation that kept us suspended in economic limbo, the possible disintegration of family structures and repeated energy crises, which undermined our sense of our country as a superpower. Now that doesn't sound timely at all. Naturally, the horror films of those decades were about faceless terrors that might jump out at us at any moment. Though A Nightmare of Elm Street, her typo, not mine, contained more gore than its predecessors, all three originals rely on shadow, suspense, and surprise to frighten us. I assume by all three she's talking Halloween, Friday the 13th, and Nightmare on Elm Street. But I don't have her thing in front of me. But today, our fears are of the terrible things happening right in front of us. Chemical weapons, gun violence, and sexual abuse, over which we seem to have no power. Not surprisingly, this decade's horror movies have focused the camera on the act of violence itself. What has all this meant for women? The original slasher films have been rightly criticized for their killer's eye views of mostly naked women running scared. I would interrupt to say if you watch enough of them, it's not necessarily mostly naked women running scared. It's one of my problems I had with... Yeah, I need to get on a rant in the middle of a quote in a long blog. Siskel and Ebert did not like slasher films. They appreciated the original Halloween, they hated the rest. In particular, they talk about Friday the 13th, the original Friday the 13th, and how it's about killing a bunch of girls, and it's, what do they call it, the men killing women films or something like that, some derogatory name. Okay, I gotta jump in from editing again because, and I think I'm about to have a rant in the recording originally about Siskel and Ebert and their opinions of slasher films, particularly the original Friday the 13th. But see, I remembered I had a copy of a special episode they did about horror films. Here's a clip from the beginning of it.
Normally on Sneak Previews, Roger and I review new movies. This week, however, we're going to be looking at a group of recent films that have some very ugly things in common. All of these films are thrillers featuring extreme violence directed at young women. To put it bluntly, what you see in most of these films is a lot of teenage girls being raped or stabbed to death, usually both. This is a depressing development in American movies, and on this show, we'll examine the nature of this trend and then speculate on why we're getting so many of these films and getting them now. A lot of moviegoers, adults and teenagers, both go to see these R-rated films, and they assume, well, they're just going to see a bunch of routine, scary pictures. But oftentimes, they're really shocked how awful these films are. As we explore this trend, we will not be showing you extreme violence in these movies. We've picked scenes that only suggest the violence. We want to inform you, not offend you.
It's just as well we're not showing some of those scenes. I think people would turn their sets off.
Yes.
To begin with, one of the things these so-called women in danger films all have in common is that they portray women as helpless victims. And after you've sat through a dozen or so of these films, as Gene and I have unfortunately had to, they all fall into the same pattern. A woman or a young girl is shown alone, isolated, and defenseless. And then come suspense-building scenes where the girl thinks she's about to be attacked, but she isn't. And then, just when you think everything's going to be okay and nothing's going to happen, a crazy killer springs out of the shadows and attacks her. And frequently, the killer sadistically threatens the victim before he strikes. That's what's happening in this scene from last year's sleazy movie, When a Stranger Calls, which has now been re-released because of the recent upsurge of the popularity of these films about attacks on women. In this scene, that woman's been told to keep the caller on the line who's been threatening her until the police can trace the call.
Hello.
That's me.
I know. Who are you? Can you see me?
Yes.
Leave me alone!
Jill, this is Sergeant Sacker. Listen to me. We've traced the call. It's coming from inside the house. Our squad car's going over there right now. Just get out of that house.
That basic scene has provided the premise for at least a dozen films in the last year. It's always the same. The girl is at home alone, the menacing attacker, the ringing telephone, the wide, frightened eyes. I think there's something terribly wrong when an image like that becomes the building block of an entire movie genre.
The thing is, the idea that they use Jill Johnson from When a Stranger Calls as an example of how horror films can't be feminist is madness to me. The whole point of that is she undergoes this thing that was a short film, by the way, the opening, which is just based on an urban legend, and then she takes control of her life as she gets older. We jump forward, I forget how many years, 5 or something, and she's an adult now, and she is very much capable. She has a life, she has a husband and her own children, and yeah, in the end, she gets some help from a detective, but he's not exactly the model of virility. That's a deliberate choice on their part in casting Charles Durning. And if you watch the sequel, When a Stranger Calls Back, even more so. He is even more out of shape. He's older. He's not, you know, a capable action hero who's going to come in and save the day, even though he is very useful. The point is that Jill Johnson is very much capable. And it's a bizarre example to use, especially when they themselves equate Psycho and Halloween as good versions of this.
I think a lot of people have the wrong idea. They identify these films with earlier thrillers like Psycho or even a more recent film like Halloween, which we both like. These films aren't in the same category. These films hate women.
Mm-hmm. When Halloween has very much the example of the thing they complain about, the girl being pushed into a corner and where she can't get out, she's being terrorized. That's what Halloween is. And they complain about POV camera when Psycho and Halloween both use that. They're inconsistent, and it pisses me off. The thing is, in the original Friday the 13th, there are more men that die than women. And it pisses me off that they categorized it that way. And that they continue to do so, talking about slasher films as these sleazy, bad things, when especially the popular ones were not that. There were some that are sleazy as fuck, trust me. There are some that are awful. There are some that are tedious. There are some that are sexist bullshit. But that's going to happen in any genre, that some are going to be particularly bad. They lumped them all together and were like, these are all bad, except for Halloween. Little asterisk, except for Halloween. Anyway, back to, who am I quoting right now? Dirt. Back to Dirt. Theoretically, shifting the camera's focus to the killer could have disrupted the male gaze. Unfortunately, the emphasis on the psychology of the killers and the focus on torture rather than the chase do just the opposite. The remakes ultimately turn women's bodies into ever more relevant, irrelevant carnage, with the Halloween remake being the most offensive both to horror fans and feminists. As I read that, I was thinking of the 2018 Halloween movie, which is more a reboot than a remake. They mean the remake from... Oh, yeah. Because they turn Rabbit Red into a strip club. They make sure that the sister... It's a sister, right? No, it's Annie. It's played by Daniel Harris, right? Like, her scene is particularly kind of brutal. Okay, I get what they're saying, I think. I don't particularly like that movie, so I don't care. But anyway, continuing.
She calls making women's bodies irrelevant, offensive. But isn't that on some level more equalizing than that switching the dynamic that Martinuzzi describes? After all, Hooks, 1981, tells us, to be feminist in any authentic sense of the term is to want for all people, female and male, liberation from sexist role patterns, domination, and oppression. I haven't even completed my list yet, but I already want to find some conclusion that suggests that Groundhog Day is somehow not sexist because Phil is an equal opportunity offender. But that seems wrong as well. In fact, the equalizing of murder victims I suggested in this very paragraph is a little wrong too. It seems to me that Phil's superiority complex and the slasher film killer's predatory nature both rise from the same patriarchal traditions that have been keeping women down for, well, ever. The idea that anyone can wield specific power over another person is inherently patriarchal, and inevitably sexist because of the aforementioned process of structuration. Men take charge by force, then they leave that power to their sons, and they to their sons, and so on. And a few generations down, we get notions like the divine right of kings. We start to believe that not only are men in charge, and we have to do what they say, but we should. And then everything we do in building our society flows around the idea that men are stronger, smarter, better. And to mix references a bit, the men in charge may be created equal, but some men are more equal than others. Everything turns hierarchical, and some men wield power over other men as well as women. We get sexism, we get racism, we get religious disputes because certain men in power in certain locales believe or purport to believe a certain way and want everyone else to follow suit. And it trickles down until we have the likes of Phil Connors insulting anyone and everyone because he A, thinks he is better than them, and B, knows that he really isn't. There's a false consciousness of his white male privilege and a certain cognitive dissonance between what is proclaimed explicitly and implicitly, and what is known on a personal level. This is where Phil Connors exists, where we all exist much of the time. And it is far easier to just keep existing in the same place than to try something new. To be continued. Today's reason to repeat a day forever. To allow any tangent to spread like wildfire. Because focus is not always the best approach. Fuck, that's this podcast. Now the question is, do I go to the previous day's entry for next week? Or the next day's entry for next week? Whoa. 'Cause we ain't getting to the science yet. No thank you.
First, I play the game. Took me round again.
I think I have traveled through time.
What is wrong in the end which never comes? Or which comes again and again? Lap, lap, lapping. Like waves.
Since the Big Bang set everything in motion, everything that happens in this universe has to be the way it is.
Man, are you hungry? I haven't eaten since later this afternoon.
Particles unfolding the way they're destined to.
How do you sleep at night? You've never seen Groundhog Day?
Yeah, you know Groundhog Day is not a documentary.
Well, here I am again, the pretty but naive one, the perky-breasted giggly one-night stand. Is it my destiny to be a brief diversion? Just a detour on the journey of some man. I'm not really one for asking. I'll play whatever role I'm cast in. A smile with perfect teeth and grimace underneath. I learned back in my teens, there's no point in protesting. If you look good in tight jeans, that's what they'll want you dressed in. Once you're known for low-cut tops, it's pretty hard to stop. It isn't easy to break free of playing Nancy. I don't really remember I chose to live in is mostly run by men. So you take what you are given just to feel the love again. So throughout the endless week and all through the weekend, you will find me roles you could play, and I'd rather be up dancing than sat against the wall. It's better to be leered at than not desired at all. Who am I to dream of better? To dream that one day I will be something more than just collateral in someone else's battle. I will be something more than Nancy.
I think at this point somebody is probably wondering why.
Why exactly?
Now? Why is this happening? I have a theory. In the last couple of months that I've been seeing these pictures, I'm convinced it has something to do with the growth of the women's movement in America in the last decade. I think that these films are some sort of primordial response by some very sick people of men saying, get back in your place, women. These women in the films are typically portrayed as independent, as sexual, as enjoying life. And the killer, typically, not all the time, but most often, is a man who is sexually frustrated with these new aggressive women. And so he strikes back at them. He throws knives at them. He can't deal with them. He cuts them up. He kills them. Get back in your place. It's against the women's movement.
I think you're basically right, Gene. You know, after you've sat through hour after hour of this complete trash, you begin to ask yourself, what did these female victims do to deserve the horrible attacks they undergo in these films? What was their crime? Why is it suddenly open season on young women in the movies? Well, one thing that most of the women victims do have is in common is that they do act independently, and I agree with you on that point. To one degree or another, they're liberated women who choose to act on their own. And the moment that a woman starts making decisions for herself in these movies, you can almost bet she's going to end up paying with her life, and horribly.